Power Company, a citizen wherever it serves. Idaho Power invites you to make Thanksgiving of 1941 your day to shine by preparing your family's dinner on your new electric range. Efficient, convenient, modern. Idaho Power Company, now celebrating their 25th anniversary.
December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy.
Recruiting offices opened across Idaho. Men enlisted and married their sweethearts before shipping out. Others were drafted. In more than one community, an entire generation enlisted together. Women kept the farms running, and some took on industrial jobs. Fearing sabotage at the power plants, the Idaho Department of Fish and Game posted armed guards at 11 Snake River dams and prohibited fishing on the reservoirs. An Army Air Corps base near Pocatello trained heavy bomber pilots. The Navy took advantage of Pocatello's train connections and built an ordnance plant to service battleship gun barrels. Materials and manpower were scarce. Companies like Idaho Power had to make do or do without.
Our new president here at Idaho Power, Mr. Clifford J. Strike, has assured his employees and our customers the company will do everything possible to assist the war effort. The ladies of our home service department are no longer selling appliances, but we're teaching our customers to plant victory gardens and to preserve food at home. We have scrap metal drives and war bond sales. Many of our men have enlisted, so the girls and I do their jobs where we can.
Even during the stress of war, electric power was not too little nor too late for the expansion of the mining industry. In 1943, Idaho Power Company built over 100 miles of high-voltage line across rugged mountain terrain and heavily forested country to reach the isolated mining community of Stibnite. And within a period of months, this single mine was producing approximately half of the domestic supply of tungsten in the United States, as well as an even greater percentage of antimony.
Used in munitions, electronics, and almost everything made of steel, the strategic metals from Stibnite were critical to the war effort. But even while the battle raged in the Pacific and in Europe, Idaho Power continued to add customers and to serve their growing demands for power. Idaho Power President C.J. Strike acquired several small electric companies. The number of customers grew from 72,000 to 115,000.
President Roosevelt signs executive orders authorizing the United States military to issue civilian exclusion orders and to build 10 internment camps in the U.S. Construction begins on the Hunt Camp, located 20 miles northeast of Twin Falls. The Idaho Power Company pushes a new transmission line across the desert to serve the camp, which will become the Minidoka War Relocation Center. With nearly 10,000 residents, Minidoka will be the eighth largest city in Idaho.
In 1943, Japanese Americans were allowed to enlist in the United States military. 1,000 men and women from the Minidoka camp served their country. 73 were killed in action. 2 received the Medal of Honor. The War Production Board directed Idaho Power and other regional utilities to build transmission lines to the Bonneville Power Administration's grid on the Columbia River. The official story was that more electricity was needed to manufacture aircraft in Seattle. The power actually supported a mysterious installation near the little town of Hanford, Washington.
Maud Laycook? Well, she was a cashier just a few months ago. When the boys joined up, no one was going out to read the meters. She knew how to do that job. All we had to do was find a company uniform that would fit her.
In all, 94 men and women from Idaho Power's 862 employees served in the armed forces. A grateful nation recognized the contributions of Idaho Power, and the U.S. Navy awarded the company its Certificate for Meritorious Service. The men came home, and the women, they returned to their office jobs or went back to managing their households. During the war, C.J. Strike was working behind the scenes, quietly preparing the company to be ready when the conflict ended.
Upper Salmon Falls Power Plant Units 3 and 4 were installed in 1947. The Malade River, a tributary of the Snake, was the site of a remarkable power development during 1948. Water from the flume is dropped through a penstock to a power plant nestled in the base of the canyon. After turning the generators in the first plant, the water continues through the flume to the bank of the Snake River, where the second power plant is located. Lower Salmon Falls plant is much larger. During 1949, four new generators will be turning out 65,000 kilowatts of power. During 1950, 75,000 kilowatts of power will be available from the Bliss generating plant.
New industries and manufacturing plants are emerging all around Idaho. Farming, ranching, livestock production, and dairy are also growing. Rural electrification had slowed during the war, but Idaho still leads the nation with nearly 23,000 electrified ranches and farms. West of Pocatello, the Farm Machinery Corporation builds the world's largest elemental phosphorus plant. J.R. Simplot, who recently joined the Idaho Power Board of Directors, opens his company's first phosphate fertilizer plant right next door. A special substation and power lines are required because the plants use as much electricity as a small city.
That long drought back in the 30s was hard on all of us dry land farmers, yes sir. Things are looking up for some of us. A couple of 3 years ago, Julian Clausen, now he's a newspaper man from Salt Lake City, he bought up 20,000 acres over here near Rupert out on the lava plain. He was going to try dry farming on a large scale. Now, Julian was down at the Thousand Springs, and he started to wondering just where did all that water come from. So he brought in a drilling rig from Oklahoma. We figured he was going after oil, and folks just thought he was crazy. He said he was drilling for water. Then we thought he was really crazy. Well, 500 feet down, he hits water, lots of it, out there in the desert. Yes, sir. Capped those new wells with pumps. He got some boys from the Idaho Power Company to run electric lines all the way out to them. Julian says there's all the water we want whenever we want it. Now, he might be right about that. He lifts 20,000 gallons a minute, fills 60 miles of ditches, growing potatoes and feed where nothing, not anything, ever grew before. We don't think he's so crazy now, no sir.
Clausen had tapped into the Snake River Plain aquifer, among the larger underground lakes in North America. He changed the way crops are grown in Idaho. No longer would farmers need to be downhill of an irrigation canal or reservoir. A drill, a well, sprinklers, and a service line to the pump were all that were needed to put hundreds of thousands of acres into production. The pump irrigator was a new type of customer for Idaho Power and a large consumer of electricity. There were now 14 power plants on the Snake River and its tributaries. Generation capacity had grown to nearly 300,000 kilowatts. The company's territory now covered 16,000 square miles.
Wherever our country needed electricity, we figured out how to get it there. When the terrible war was over, we were ready to meet the new demand for electricity and to sell the appliances and tools to the people who were going to use it. And when we wanted to build new hydroelectric power plants, the government said yes, to most of them anyway. Mr. Strike was turned down on two of his projects. Government said there were environmental concerns. Regulators wanted answers to questions about how those power plants might impact the scenery, recreation, wildlife, and fish in the river.
Future projects were on hold, and without government approval for them, the company might struggle to meet the energy needs of a growing population. To ensure generation capacity would keep pace with the demand for electricity, Idaho Power had to actively and conscientiously begin to examine environmental issues.
are now concluding our broadcast day. Tune in tomorrow morning for news, weather, and the farm report. To Mr. and Mrs. Idaho and all the farmers in the fields, we wish you good night and good luck.